Good evening to all law students and legal professionals who have joined with us in this webinar lecture series presented by Legal Trendsetter on the topic Fundamental Duties under the Indian Constitution by Subodh Markandeya sir. Sir was educated in Hyderabad, enrolled in 1962 as advocate by the Bar Council of Andhra Pradesh. He practiced in Hyderabad and Allahabad before shifting in 1968 to Supreme Court of India. He became the Standing Counsel of Union of India and the State of UP and Public Undertaking Allahabad High Court and various High Court. He practiced in the area of constitutional law, law varying of public services, religious endorsement, public women urban development, medical education, land acquisition development, foreign exchange and foreign trade. Due to largely his advocacy clause C of Article 378D, 371D, which provided for the announcement of the judgment and order of administrative tribunal by the state government was struck down by the Supreme Court, the bill of attendance. Now I would like to invite sir, please join the webinar session. Now it's up to you, sir.
Shall I start? So, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am very happy to participate in this webinar organized by Mr. Sudhanshu Tripathi and his group, which is called Legal Trendsetters. So, this evening's subject is Fundamental Duties under the Constitution of India. I will start by saying that rights and duties are inseparable twins. States' duties are rights of citizens and vice versa. I have divided this address into four parts. First, I will give a little background by way of some history. Then I will discuss the nature and scope of fundamental duties. Then I would like to say what should be the suggested interpretation of Part 4A of the Constitution. And lastly, I will end up by a critique of Supreme Court's judgment in Bijoy Emanuel's case, which I think should be overruled because it has caused a lot of confusion. So let me start by taking up these four parts one by one. Even before our country attained independence, the process of framing the Constitution of India had started with the first meeting of the Constituent Assembly on the 9th December 1946. So it was a period of great turmoil. Partition had happened. Millions of people had poured in from across the new country called Pakistan. And we were faced with the stark reality of 500 odd Indian princes who had become sovereign by virtue of the India Independence Act. And in spite of all these difficulties, it must be said to the credit of the constitution makers that they met day after day after day. And in spite of all the turmoil going around them, they focused on their work, and it was a complex process. First, each article had to be introduced in the Constituent Assembly, then debated, and then amendments were suggested. And after all the debates, each article was adopted. At the end of this, the entire Constitution, including its preamble, was adopted. So I must pay tribute to the members of the Constituent Assembly for diligently doing this great job. The entire Constitution as a whole was adopted by the Constituent Assembly on 26th of November 1949, which we now celebrate as Law Day. The Constitution of India was inaugurated on 26 January 1950. It's world's longest and most complex constitution. Its scope and reach is monumental. But like all human endeavors, it had several deficiencies which were sought to be removed later by enacting more than 100 amendments to the Constitution of India. One such deficiency was that the Constitution was heavily loaded with emphasis on the fundamental rights, with no provision for corresponding fundamental duties of the citizen. This is to a degree understandable, because people of India were deprived of most basic human rights and other rights, religious rights, for centuries of despotic rule. Therefore, defining and safeguarding the fundamental rights was uppermost in the minds of our founding fathers. Dr. Durgadas Basu, who was a judge, who was an author of great books on Constitution of India, in his Tagore Law Lectures, delivered in 1968-69, was perhaps the first one to draw our attention to this deficiency in our Constitution. This deficiency was later remedied by 42nd Amendment, which, amongst other things, added Part 4A to the Constitution of India. It contains Article 51A, a single article. There are some parallel provisions to Part 4A of the Indian Constitution, and these can be found in Article 19(1) of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, 1948, adopted by the General Assembly of the United Nations, Articles 59 to 69 of the Constitution of the USSR, Articles 12, 26, 27, and 30 of the Constitution of Japan, what is called popularly as MacArthur Constitution, and Article 12 of the Constitution of People's Republic of China, 1975. Initially, the legitimacy of 42nd Amendment was highly suspect. It was enacted during the emergency on the basis of the recommendations of a committee called Swaran Singh Committee, which was appointed by the President of the Indian National Congress. At that time, most of the opposition leaders and even some Congress leaders were under preventive detention. The deliberations on the changes of most far-reaching character in our Constitution was confined to the party in power with very little public participation. Swaran Singh Committee had suggested the empowerment of Parliament to impose punishment for breaches of fundamental duties, but that suggestion was dropped when the bill, which ultimately culminated in 42nd Amendment, was introduced in the Lok Sabha. Speaking in the lower house of India's Parliament, Prime Minister Indira Gandhi, on 28th October 1976, had said that the object of fundamental duties was not to smother rights, but to establish democratic balance. This is what she said. When Indira Gandhi's government was ultimately defeated in 1977, and for the first time in the 27-year history of Republican India, the government which then came in power repealed most of the partisan provisions of the 42nd Amendment. As you know, there were some very obnoxious provisions, like one article comes immediately to my mind, and that is Article 329, capital A, and that provision was really obnoxious because it abolished all the remedies to challenge the election of the Prime Minister and the Speaker of Lok Sabha. But Part 4A was retained. It was said to be a salutary provision. Here I would like to say that National Commission for Review of Working of the Constitution, which was constituted on 22nd February 2000 under the chairmanship of the former Chief Justice of India, Mr. Justice M.N. Venkatachalaya, in its report suggested following twofold measures in regard to Part 4. So, first measure that was suggested was that the following should be included as fundamental duties. So, duty to vote and actively participate in the democratic process, duty to pay taxes, duty to foster family values and responsible parenthood in the matter of education of children, and duty to require the industrial organizations to provide education to children of their employees. The second measure which was suggested was that there was a report by Justice M.S. Justice J.S. Verma Committee on the teaching of fundamental duties to the citizens of India, including as part of the curriculum throughout the country. Justice Verma Committee had submitted a detailed report running into two volumes of 425 pages, and it contains a list of summary of as many as 138 cases decided by the Supreme Court bearing on Part 4A. It has been published by the Ministry of Human Resources Development. Now, originally, 10 sets of duties were enumerated in clauses A to J of Article 51, capital A. I think it would be good to read here the provisions of Part 51A. So, Article 51A reads, I quote, fundamental duties. It shall be the duty of every citizen of India to abide by the Constitution and respect its ideals and institutions, the national flag and the national anthem. B, to cherish and follow the noble ideals which inspired our struggle for freedom. C, to uphold and protect the sovereignty, unity and integrity of India. D, to defend the country and render national service when called upon to do so. E, to promote harmony and spirit of common brotherhood amongst all people of India, transcending religious, linguistic, regional and sectional diversities. To renounce practice derogatory to the dignity of women. F, to value and preserve the rich heritage of our composite culture. G, to protect and improve the natural environment, including forests, lakes, rivers, wildlife, and to have compassion for living creatures. H, to develop scientific temper, humanism, and spirit of inquiry and reform. J, to safeguard public property and abjure violence. And J, to strive towards excellence in all the spheres of individual and collective activity so that the nation constantly rises to higher levels of endeavor and achievement. So, one more clause, namely clause K, was added. This became necessary because in 2002, Article 21A was introduced in the Constitution, which created a fundamental right to education. So corresponding duty, fundamental duty, had to be also enacted. So clause K was added to Article 51A. It imposes on the parents and guardians of children between the age of 6 to 14 fundamental duty to provide education to their children or wards, as the case may be. Fundamental duties have thus come to stay in our constitutional scheme. I think it is salutary. There can't be any rights without the duties. Now let us see the as nature and scope of fundamental duties. A host of questions arise in regard to the fundamental duties. Are they enforceable? And if so, by whom? Are they addressed to the state as defined in Article 12? What are the consequences of non-obedience? So in my humble view, Part 4A is just like Part 4, Directive Principles, and the 7th Schedule and some other provisions in the Constitution, which provide a veritable source of exercise of legislative power. So this is a source of legislative power. At least Supreme Court, with its vast and inexhaustible judicial power under Article 142 of the Constitution, can and has indeed used Article 51 capital A as a source of judicial power, at least in three fields I have been able to pinpoint. Number one is environmental protection. So Justice Verma Committee itself has pointed out a very large number of cases where the Supreme Court itself has invoked Article 51A while itself suggesting, you know, changes and almost because under Article 142, Supreme Court has vast powers to give directions to do complete justice. So in exercise of that power, they have invoked Article 51A. But on my search, I have also found that the Supreme Court has also used Article 51A, read with Article 142, to provide for the dignity of women in the famous Vishakha case. And similarly, for the prevention of destruction of public property also, there is a case that is in the protection of public property versus state of Andhra Pradesh. So at least in these three areas, the Supreme Court itself has used and invoked Article 51 capital A for exercising judicial power under Article 142. Another aspect which we must note is that, as we read out from Article 51A, all duties, whether fundamental or otherwise, involve a degree of compulsion. Consequently, our approach has to be imperative and not permissive in interpreting Article 51A, and that is the right approach, the imperative approach and not the permissive approach for correctly construing Article 51A. Moreover, I also humbly submit that you have to see what would be the cascading effect of interpreting one clause on other clauses of Article 51A. So it has to be read as a whole, because one will have the cascading effect on the other. This has to be always borne in mind. Where each fundamental duty, I would say that wherever each fundamental duty begins, the fundamental right vanishes. I'll just illustrate. The fundamental right to freedom of speech and expression will end where your duty under Clause A begins. In other words, there is no fundamental right to flout the Constitution or to disrespect the ideals and institutions or the national flag or national anthem. I may also say that abiding and respecting has to be in the full extent. There is no half a house in duties. Therefore, use of national anthem and national flag for commercial purpose, disturbing of the hoisting or unfurling of the national flag, failure to sing or salute, or interruption or prevention or any other quirky approach to these solemn duties is just not permissible. So it is in this context that I wish to lastly say that the Supreme Court judgment in Bijo Emmanuel versus State of Kerala requires to be overruled. And I'll deal with this extensively at the end of this address. Now let us see what kind of interpretation we should adopt for Article 51. So one notable feature is that there is common opening part of Article 51, capital A, and it uses the word shall, and it governs all the clauses A to K. This means, beyond any reasonable doubt, that all duties are fundamental and they are also mandatory and not merely directory. This also means that they have to be performed by all citizens with no exceptions, or in any event with least exceptions. In my view, the golden rule of interpretation should be adopted. What's that golden rule? You have to inquire what is the object which is sought to be achieved by enacting any particular provision, either in the Constitution or in a law. And this should be adopted uniformly for fundamental duties. Therefore, you will have to ascertain the object and purpose of adding Part 4A to the Constitution and adopt only that interpretation which advances that object and purpose, and eschew and give up that interpretation which would defeat, diminish, or retard the object of insertion of Part 4A. I think that since fundamental duties have been created in favor of the state, the fact that they are not addressed to the state is irrelevant. Therefore, kindly see what I'm suggesting. Therefore, supposing there is a child or ward whose parent fails or neglects to perform the duty under Clause K, then after bringing this fact to the notice of the concerned authorities of the state, you can move the court, the child can move the court for appropriate relief, compelling the parent or guardian to perform his duty as mandated by Article 21A, read with Clause K. In this connection, let us compare the three provisions of Part 3, Fundamental Rights, Part 4, that is Directive Principles of State Policy, and Part 4A, that is Fundamental Duties. Fundamental rights are guaranteed under Part 3 of the Constitution. They have been specifically made enforceable by the combined effect of Article 12, which defines state, Article 13, which provides that all pre-constitutional laws must pass the litmus test of consistency with the provisions of Part 3, and prohibiting the state from making any law that takes away or abridges the rights guaranteed by Part 3, and laying down the consequences, namely the violation of Part 3 renders any such law to be void. And then remedies are provided in Articles 32 to the Supreme Court and Article 26. Providing for the constitutional remedies for the enforcement of fundamental rights. By virtue of specific provision of Article 37, provisions of Part 4 are not enforceable. Kindly note this. But there is no provision in Part 4A, that is Fundamental Duties, which specifically makes either the provision of Part 4A enforceable or non-enforceable. Thus, Part 4A stands somewhere between Part 3 and Part 4. That is, specifically, it neither makes them enforceable nor makes them unenforceable. But none of the judgments which hold that Part 4 is non-enforceable has taken this important aspect into account. And just see this. In spite of its non-enforceability of Part 4, the Supreme Court in State of UP versus Harishankar Jain, AIR 1980 SC 65, has held like this, I quote, "The mandate of Article 37 of the Constitution is that while the directive principles of state policy shall not be enforceable by any court, the principles and are nevertheless fundamental in the governance of the country." Addressed to the court, what this injunction means is that while the courts are not free to direct the making of any legislation, courts are bound to evolve, affirm, and adopt principles of interpretation which will further and not hinder the goal set out in the directive principles of state policy. This command of the Constitution must be ever present in the minds of judges when interpreting statutes which concern themselves directly or indirectly with matters set out in the directive principles of state policy. So I say that the above principles equally apply, or maybe apply with even greater force, since Article 51 is not, has no non-enforceability clause like Article 37. Moreover, by their very nature, fundamental duties imply some degree of compulsion and enforceability, and consequently non-tolerance of laxity or permissibility in their obedience by the citizens. To hold otherwise would have very serious consequences in enforcing the provisions of Part 4A, and especially, just see, how will you enforce Clause C unless it is held to be mandatory? Clause C says, which enjoins the citizen to uphold and protect the sovereignty, unity, and integrity of India. Just see about Clause D also, which requires the citizens to defend the country and render national service when called upon to do. Then also last part of Clause E, which commands the citizens to renounce practices derogatory to the dignity of women. And then Clause I, which casts a duty on them to safeguard public property and abjure violence. Therefore, you can't interpret that they are merely nice words. They have to be per se implemented. So it is in the light of this submission that I'll now pass on to my last part, that is critic of Bijo Emmanuel case. Let us see how did the case of Bijo Emmanuel arise. Bijo Emmanuel's case arose because these three children who filed this writ petition before the Kerala High Court, it was original petition number 7701 of 1985 under Article 226 of the Constitution, filed by the parents of three school children. So briefly, their case was that they belonged to a Christian sect called Jehovah's Witnesses. Chanting of national anthem in the school assembly every morning before the commencement of classes involves worship of God other than Jehovah, which is prohibited in their religion. They applied for exemption from singing the national anthem, but the authorities took too long a time to decide, leading to the infringement of their fundamental rights under Articles 25, 26, 19, 1A, and so on. Now, it came up before the learned single judge for final hearing, and pleadings before him disclosed that the school education in the state of Kerala is governed by the Kerala Education Act and the rules made therein, and the circulars, comment orders, etc., issued by the Director of Public Instructions dealing with singing of national anthem. So they were not, they had statutory. Had statutory flavor and statutory force. And it also showed that since 1961, national anthem is being sung in all these schools across the state of Kerala. And there was no trouble or problem. The students belonging to the same religion, that is Jehovah's Witnesses, had earlier asked for a similar exemption, which was rejected on 30th of January 1965, and since then all the students in the state were singing national anthem without any exception. The learned single judge dismissed the writ petition on these findings. Number one, that Jehovah's Witnesses registered as a charitable society and it's not a religious denomination, and therefore no fundamental rights under Articles 25, 26 can be claimed. Then number two, under Article 51A, showing respect to the national anthem by singing is a constitutional duty and mandate. Any exemption from singing national anthem by some students would develop a tendency to ignore the constitutional mandate. It would be unequal also, if I may add, and would have bad effect on the other pupils. So the learned single judge dismissed the writ petition. Then the students filed writ appeal number 483 of 1985. The division bench, of course, proceeded on the assumption that Jehovah's Witnesses is a religion. It did not agree with the learned single judge that it's not a religion, but then went on to decide whether fundamental rights guaranteed by Articles 25 and 26 were infringed. The division bench traced the history of our national anthem and read its original text and authentic translation, recorded a finding that India's national anthem is poet's own well-tuned song glorifying India. It is not a religious song. Its singing is not a religious ceremony. It's a patriotic song, and it's a patriotic activity. Therefore, the request made by the children belonging to Jehovah's Witnesses was rightly rejected way back on 30th of January 1965, and thereafter all children, without exception, sang the national anthem without any trouble. The division bench also noticed the reasons which led to the enactment of the Prevention of Insult to the National Honours Act 1971 and noted its salient features and held that when the entire school shows respect by singing the national anthem, any deviation is not permissible. It amounts to disrespect and also discrimination. Who are those pupils who sing the national anthem? It further held, on the basis of ratio of a large number of cases, like Shirur Mutt's case, from Shirur Mutt's case right up to the recently delivered case on triple talaq, the Supreme Court has held that Supreme Court will enforce only that particular practice of a religion which is fundamental to the propagation, practice, and of that particular religion. The division bench therefore held that there is no trace or element of religious worship in singing national anthem, and consequently, the religious freedom of the petitioners is not at all abridged by requiring them to sing the national anthem, and there is no violation of their fundamental rights under Articles 25 and 26. The division bench therefore dismissed the appeals, and children therefore filed specialty petition, which gave rise to civil appeal number 870 before the Supreme Court. And Supreme Court held like this. Number one, requirement of compulsory singing of the national anthem results in infringement of fundamental rights guaranteed by Article 19(1)(a). There is no provision in law obliging anyone to sing national anthem, nor is it disrespectful to the national anthem if persons stand up when national anthem is being sung or played, but do not sing themselves. Section 3 of the Prevention of Insults to National Honor Act required that no one should prevent or disturb the singing or playing the national anthem. Whenever fundamental right to freedom of conscience and profess, practice and propagate religion is invoked, the act offending fundamental rights must be examined to find whether it is to protect public order, morality or health; b, it is to give effect to the other provisions of Part 3 of the Constitution; or c, it is authorized by law regulating or restricting any economic, financial, political, secular activity associated with the religious practice, or provide social welfare or reform. Any law under clauses 2-6 of Article 19 must be a law having statutory force and not an executive order or departmental instruction, circular, etc. They don't have any statutory basis. And 6, that article, and lastly, Articles 19(1)(a), 25 are clearly infringed. And lastly, whether a religious practice appeals to the court is irrelevant. It's the belief of the practitioner of that religion which matters. I think this judgment is clearly wrong. First of all, this is not as I said, that from Shirur Math case right up to the Triple Talaq case, Supreme Court has unanimously, in a large number of cases, have held that court will protect only those religious practices and beliefs which are central or fundamental to the practitioner of that particular religion. That's how the Triple Talaq was abolished. I mean, court struck it down. So let me now formulate. Vijay Emanuel's case, besides being wrong in law, as I pointed out, that those circulars had statutory favor. They were made under Kerala Education Act, and the rules made thereunder. And the Director of Public Instructions had the power to issue statutory orders. So the circulars and government orders were statutory in flavor as well as in its force. Secondly, as I, even on the point of repetition, I'm saying that the Supreme Court has held unanimously in large number of cases that Supreme Court will protect and enforce only that right which is fundamental to. Otherwise, so many quirky religions have, I'm giving a very extreme example. Supposing some person who professes, let us say, Jainism or Buddhism, says that, no, I will not defend the country. I will just not defend the country because my religion believes in ahimsa. I can give even a more, shocking example, but I will refrain from doing so. So, therefore, permissibility is just not the way to interpret part 4. It's the mandatory nature, imperativeness. And then I have great respect for Mr. Justice Chinnappa Reddy, who was one of our most articulate judges. But he overlooked his own law, which he laid down in Harishankar's case, which I earlier read, that court has to evolve principles of law to affirm and affirms, that is, to evolve and affirm the rules of interpretation which are in consonance with Part 4A, as he said about Part 4. So Part 4A also is a part of the Constitution. You have to look at the reasons why this was enacted. And the party which came in power the very next year, the very next term, revealed large number of provisions of 42nd Amendment, but it specifically retained, if you look at the Lok Sabha debates and Rajya Sabha debates of those days, you will find that member after member said that yes, fundamental duties must be retained. And how can there be any right without any duty? If we cannot stand for our national anthem for 45 minutes, or if we are shy to sing it, I think we are failing in our duty to our nation. And as the learned single judge pointed out and the division bench pointed out, it is not at all a religious song. It, this singing of national anthem is not at all a religious practice. It's a national practice, or you can say it's a national duty, or it's national in its nature. It pervades all. It is across the religious lines it has to apply. So, therefore, I was saying that right from Shirur Math case, right up to Triple Talaq case, court has held that such of the practices of a religion which are held to be fundamental to the profession, practicing and propagation of that religion, alone will be enforced by the superior courts. And then, as I said, even on the pain of repetition, I'm saying that this judgment in Bijoy Emmanuel case was also by Justice Chinnappa Reddy. So he did not remember. If he had remembered, he would have followed his own decisions in Harishankar Jain's case. That is to say, evolve, affirm, and adopt principles of interpretation which will further and not hinder the goals set out in Part 4A of the Constitution. To my knowledge, immediately after Bijoy Emmanuel's case, a review petition was filed under Article 137. To review the judgment of Bijoy Emmanuel. That was filed by Attorney General himself. Mr. Parasaran himself filed, saying that it's wrongly decided. I think it's high time to overrule that decision, because it has, as I said, it has very importance, are very of far-reaching consequences. Then fundamental duties must simply be forgotten. Because supposing if you can't stand up for 58 seconds, or if you can't sing, did you ever go to fight for your country only? If such an interpretation is put, then supposing a law is brought, like Supreme Court itself gave that judgment in Vishakha's case, no, to uphold the dignity of woman. As a matter of fact, it legislated and said these directions will remain in force till the legislation is brought either by the center or all the states. Therefore, what did they do? They enforced the fundamental duties. And Article 51A has been invoked in all the cases where environment is involved. Environmental degradation is involved. Therefore, I'm of the firm view, to sum up, I'm of the firm view that Vijay Emmanuel's case should be over. I'm very grateful to Mr. Sudhanshu Tripathi and his team for giving me this opportunity of addressing you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.